25 years ago, the Union of Concerned Scientists penned the 1992 World Scientists Warning to Humanity. They called on humankind to curtail environmental destruction and warned that a great change in our stewardship of the Earth and the life on it is required if vast human misery is to be avoided. Today, with little concrete action taken and the warming of our planet accelerating, scientists have written a second warning. I talked to two of the authors of this piece, Professors William Ripple and Christopher Wolfe, to ask them about their warning and what we can do about it. Here's our conversation. I am here with Professors Christopher Wolfe and William Ripple, two of the authors of the World Scientists Warning to Humanity, A Second Notice. Thank you, both of you, for being with me today.
Well, thank you. We're glad to be here.
Thanks.
So why did you write this warning? Was the first warning not enough? And why write it now?
Yes. The first warning happened in 1992, and by the way, this is Bill Ripple speaking. It happened in 1992, and it was organized by the Union of Concerned Scientists, and they had over 1,700 scientists sign the first warning to humanity, and back last year, before we wrote this paper, I realized that it had been exactly 25 years since the first warning. And I also realized that there are now global data sets available to look at change over time since 1992. And at that point, I had the aha moment to suggest a second warning paper, and I suggested that to Chris Wolfe, and he liked the idea, so we started working on it.
So you have over 15,000 signatories to this letter. What basic change did you see from the 92 letter till now? And because obviously that's a much higher number than you said, like 1,000 on the first warning. What has changed among the community of scientists? Is it just more verification of the data and your hypotheses, or has the problem, the time running out, just created a new sense of urgency?
So things have generally gotten much worse since the first warning was put out. So I think scientists are more concerned now, especially we plotted about 10 different global variables, and everything was getting worse except the ozone depleting chemicals, the emissions of those. So I think there's a sense of urgency among scientists now. Chris, do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I agree. I think it's definitely more of a sense of urgency. Also, just on the logistical side, in terms of getting signatories and coordinating a big project like this, we've come a long way since 1992, when I was 5 years old. Right. And I think it's a lot easier to coordinate a big project, have a website, spread this kind of information around. So that's helped a lot as well.
Yeah, and social media especially was useful. We now have over 20,000 signatories. We're still collecting signatures on the paper.
Wow. That's so. Question for both of you then. Let's say worst case scenario. Let's say there's no major action at all on climate change, no reduction in carbon emissions. What does the world look like by the end of this century?
Well, I'll give you a brief response, and that would be my concern is that there's going to be great misery for humanity, and some of my colleagues are even talking about the possibility of humans going extinct someday in the future. So there's great concern here.
Yeah, I agree. And in particular, one thing we tried to highlight is that a lot of these threats are particularly prominent or major issues for a developing world where people might not have as much money or resources to deal with some of these things. So that's really a big issue in terms of things like hunger and issues associated with really major population growth. So it's definitely a global issue here.
Yeah, so, Chris, that's a good point, because many of the most vulnerable people on the planet don't have the resources that the West has in terms of coping with things like climate change and water shortages and a number of other types of environmental issues.
It's interesting that you mentioned that, because one of the questions I wanted to ask you was about getting people in the West who the U.S. has the biggest per capita carbon emissions, and certainly if we took the lead, it would make a big difference. I've got a relative in Chicago who, when I talk to him about climate change, he goes, yeah, okay, let me know when Indiana's underwater. you know, I mean, these are – he's not denying it, denying that it's real, but there's kind of this attitude that human beings have nature under their thumb, or that we'll figure some technological fix out. I guess my question is, for people out there who do accept climate change but who think that we in the West are going to be able to ride it out, or we'll adapt, or there would be some tech fix to it all, what do you say to those people?
Well, I mean, part of what makes this such a big issue is that with something like climate change, you know, we all share the same atmosphere and climate, right, really broadly speaking. So I don't think it's necessarily a case that certain regions will be totally immune to any issues like that. There's also a lot of, like, subtler or second-order kind of issues, like maybe conflict increasing worldwide, those sorts of things. So it's definitely a case where there could be problems for people all over the world.
And also, another response to your friend might be just to look at the trends in the United States for forest fires, for extreme heat, for extreme storms, extreme precipitation, hurricanes. The new climate is arriving, and it is already causing great it's already at a great cost and misery to the people that live in the United States.
It's interesting, because there are people out there who say, oh, well, we've always had forest fires, we've always had hurricanes, we've always had droughts. Is there any way, besides getting really deep into the data and doing the kind of work that you both do, which is very high level and academic, of proving to these people or demonstrating that, no, this is not just normal weather patterns, this is a qualitative difference?
There are time trend data that show that these extreme weather events are increasing, and the number of forest fires are increasing dramatically over time. So any single weather event or fire cannot be directly attributed to climate change, but if you look at everything as a whole, the trends are obvious.
Yeah, within the scientific community, what's sort of the attitude about this issue in terms of getting the public on board? Because obviously, part of this warning to humanity is waking up the public. So how much of this is about messaging in terms of crafting, you know, the right message that hits people with urgency? And how much of this is just a war against powerful, entrenched forces who don't want to give up burning fossil fuels, mass factory farms, et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a challenge for scientists, is trying to make their work accessible to the public. And, you know, for instance, in America, there's kind of a political climate where some people think, you know, what do scientists know, or who cares what they have to say? Right. So it is a challenge for sure. And I think one thing we tried to do in this paper is to make the scientist warning or the second notice as accessible as possible. So it's the sort of thing that people from all sorts of backgrounds could read, compared to some much more technical literature that would be harder for people to follow.
Yes, like the news about our article has been tweeted nearly 9,000 times to up to 14 million followers. Wow. So we're pleased that the public has latched on to it and is spreading the word. But it is difficult on some of these environmental issues, since they're long-term issues and gradual issues, to get humanity and involved in a serious way. Because if the threat was immediate, for example, if there were bombs coming towards the United States, for example, there would be a very rapid response. But this is something that's a little bit removed from the everyday living, and it makes it difficult to get to a high priority.
Yeah, that seems to be one of the big problems with it. I have another friend who, kind of along the lines that you mentioned about humans going extinct, says that, well, there's a possibility that we fix it, but it seems unlikely. And if human beings go extinct, the Earth will live on, and just like the dinosaurs, after they passed, a new breed of life form will come about, and that'll be okay. Are we at a point still where there's time to avoid the worst effects of climate change, or you don't want to give people permission to give up, but do you see what I'm saying? If there's nothing that can be done, do you think that there's a sort of a peace in that sort of nihilism?
With regard to this question of humans will go extinct, my suspicion is eventually we will, right. If we look at a sufficiently long time scale. So there's kind of this will we go extinct or not question, but there's also we can think of it as not just being binary, but what are the outcomes like for humans in the next 100 or 1,000 years or something like that. So from that perspective, like everything we could do can potentially help like reduce suffering for humans and for the planet and the environment in the future. So that's our hope, I think.
And obviously you have your professional work and writing papers and reaching out to the public, but on an individual level, how have you changed your behavior? What are the best actions people can take as individuals?
Well, we can both mention a few things. So I think for me, this bill, I think reducing the use of fossil fuels, so I've reduced those dramatically in my life, and I've switched to a plant-based diet since meat diets. Diets that are high in meat intake have much higher environmental and climate impacts. And I shop at stores that are things like thrift shops, where I buy used items rather than new, or I borrow items that I need. So I just try to reduce consumption. Chris, anything on your part?
Yeah, I mean, I try to do some things along similar lines. So for instance, avoiding eating meat. In particular, some meat like beef is very unfriendly to the environment, has a lot of issues in terms of fossil fuel production, other things like that associated with it. Another one that's pretty easy for me is avoiding air travel as much as possible. Well, I don't like flying, but aside from that, there's a lot of CO2 emissions associated with air travel. So now with things like Skype and stuff, it's possible to have meetings with people all over without having to fly everywhere. So that's another thing that can help.
Okay. And what What are your thoughts? Because obviously, once new administration came in, that changed a lot in terms of the outlook for what we would do as a country in terms of tackling climate change. But I wanted to ask you a specific question. What are your thoughts on the Trump administration's reevaluation of all national monuments for the past 24 years? Do you have any thoughts on that, or where that might go, how that might affect our environment?
Well, this you're asking a question about reserves and parks, right, and monuments, and those are very important to the global environment. It's not just in the United States, but there are these types of reserves all over the world, both in marine areas and in terrestrial areas. So generally, they're thought to be really important. And in our scientist warning paper, we recommend that reserves be a high priority. So in general, I think that they're very important for the conservation of resources, biodiversity and water and land, and they would be more typically more resilient to climate change. So they're important areas. Now, in terms of the current administration, I don't have any comment other than the administrations come and go, but policies are constantly shifting. So right, soon we'll have new administrators. Chris, do you have any thoughts?
I mean, I agree. Reserves have a great deal of benefits. They can protect endangered species. They have value, like culturally, to humans. They can have forests that can help with climate change mitigation. So there's a lot of different reasons to care about reserves, and it's just kind of part of our heritage that I think is really important.
One of the problems that you mentioned in your article was that, and I think it kind of has something to do with the, you're talking about trying to reduce your consumption, this fixation on a growth economy where we're constantly trying to grow the economy, whether or not that means that we're improving lives for people rather than just increasing the size of the pie. Could you talk just a little bit more about that, what that has to do with climate change?
Well, the growth economy is problematic because the biosphere is fixed, and the economy and the economists have the idea that growth continues unlimited for over the long run, and that's just a collision course in my view. So what I think is needed is for people, especially the economists, to be taking into account the limits of the biosphere when they are doing economic work.
Yeah, and I just would add that I think it's important to think about growth in like different ways. So it's not necessarily that we just want to maximize having as much material resources as possible, for instance. But I mean, there's other ways in which economies could grow, like in terms of our knowledge or understanding, that sort of thing. So just maybe defining it a little bit more broadly could help give some perspective there.
Interesting. Back in 2009, there was a climate change summit in Copenhagen that failed. Do you have any insight into why it failed and how big of a missed opportunity was this?
Well, I don't have any insights. I don't recall the specifics of that meeting, but these global climate change meetings are important because we have to work as a global community to try to mitigate climate change.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. These things are inherently challenging because we're trying to coordinate with ideally the whole world, so countries all over. And then it's common that, you know, different countries or different politicians will feel like their interests are not being represented fully. So it kind of creates some tension. For instance, in the developing world, climate change is a big issue, but people might not have as many resources to combat it. So that sort of makes the negotiations a little bit more complicated, I think.
Interesting. So what, as we're talking about this, and what do you think is the most likely scenario, the most likely course for humanity to take? I mean, it's almost impossible to predict going any decades out, let alone hundreds of years. But based on your understanding of the issue, how far we've gone along, and the fact that, at least my understanding is, these positive feedback loops are almost exponential, and at a certain point kind of get it becomes close to impossible to undo them. Is that correct? And if so, what does that mean for the rest of us?
Yeah, I think that's the right idea in general. Sometimes people will think, like, if a certain variable that we're concerned about increases, maybe there's just a linear increase in terms of other things we might care about. But there's also, like you mentioned, lots of potential feedbacks. In science and climate change, there's this idea of state shifts. There's a paper on state shifts in Earth's biosphere. So that maybe if we push some of these variables too far, we can have relatively rapid fundamental changes in the way the environment or the biosphere functions or doesn't function. And those can be hard to predict exactly what they entail. It's probably not good since we can't really adapt to those circumstances. And they can also be very hard to reverse. So it's not the case that we can just sort of do the opposite thing for a while and then we're back to where we started.
Okay. One last question, because I know you guys are busy and you have much more important work than talking to me, but what...
Your questions are great, by the way. Yeah.
Oh, thank you. What... what was I going to say? So, is it ever depressing to be involved in these issues on a day-in, day-out basis and knowing what you know and knowing the consequences and looking around at the greater society and not seeing, at least by our leaders, not major action being taken?
Well, that's a good question that you have. And sometimes I feel discouraged. And I also... generally have a great hope for humanity that we will somehow arise to the occasion and to the challenge, and at some point our efforts become much more than they are or much more than they have been. So I'm a cautious optimist, and but at the same time I think we are in a big trouble. And that it's just crucial that we work together to try to solve some of these global environmental and climate problems. This is our home, and we need to be able to have a sustainable livelihood for humanity. So that's what I talk about. And also, as a scientist, I'm just fascinated by the process. So I'm normally not too depressed and discouraged about it, but I find it interesting, and I feel like I just want to do what I can about important critical challenge that we have.
Yeah, I definitely agree. I think if we all just all do what we can, that's about all we can do and kind of hope for the best. It's been really exciting to be able to work on the Scientist's Warning Project with Bill and the other co-authors, because I think it has or has the potential to make a difference. There's a website that goes along with the project, and when we had first set it up, I looked and there was one signatory for the paper.
Yeah.
So I thought, I hope we get at least a few more. it's been really exciting seeing how it's kind of taken off, and hopefully we can keep up the momentum.
What's the name of the website? for people to know?
Well, we can we can email it to you, and then if you want to,
I'll include it at the end, sure.
As a link. So there's two websites. One, scientists can still sign our paper, and they can click on that and be a signatory, even though we've already published. And then I will send you a second website where non-scientist individuals can endorse the paper, as well as organizations can endorse it. So I'll send you links to two websites. And is there a way you can put those next to your?
Yeah,
your...
I can include them in the show notes.
Okay, good.
Great.
So, Professor Bill Ripple, Professor Christopher Wolf, thank you very much for your time, and thank you for joining me today.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
And we'll look forward to listening to your production.
Absolutely. All right, that's our show, folks. I included the links they gave in the description. Hope you enjoyed. See you next time.